Good morning. Welcome to Northwest Christian Church. We are so excited to have you here this morning. At this time, would you please all stand with us and let's sing songs of praise to our God this morning.
Reach out. From the darkness, I called your name. Into darkness, your mercy came. You called me out, lifting me up. How great is your love? You bore my weakness, you took my shame, buried my burdens in fields of grace. You called me out, lifted me up. How great is your love?
There will never be. Amen. Before we continue, you can have a seat. Before we continue, I want to give you a brief update. Last Monday, Pastor David had surgery to remove some cancer, and he just wanted to let you guys know that everything is good. He's home, he's recovering, but he would love to still have prayer. And so continue to pray for Pastor David. We love him. And he also wanted me to let you know to pray for one other thing, too. We have some friends, some people that we know in Puerto Rico. Puerto Rico is facing a lot of challenges right now because it is experiencing earthquakes almost daily since December. It is tragic. It is ruining families, ruining homes, and so he wants us to pray for that as well. So right now, if we could bow our heads and pray, that would be great. God, we thank you so much for everything you've given us. We thank you that you are the almighty healer, that we should go to you for peace and comfort, and that you provide that 100%. Thank you for David. Thank you for his leadership, but I pray that you may heal him, give him comfort, give him peace, even in times in which he's experiencing pain, Lord. Pray for the country of Puerto Rico. I pray that you may help them, help their efforts in fixing what has been devastated, Lord, and I just pray that you may be able to provide relief and aid and spur on others to help in that regard. We love you and we thank you. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Well, it's great to see you on this Sunday morning. Are you guys doing well? You made it? Got your umbrellas? We're in Oregon. We don't use umbrellas. All right. That's all right. We have a couple different things we want you to know. We're really excited about today. We're excited about tonight because we are kicking off 10 weeks of Rooted. That is our 10-week small group experience, and we would love for you to be involved with that, even if you haven't given it thought. Go ahead and do some research. Go to the Grow kiosk in the back, and they'll be able to help you out with any information. But that starts tonight at 6. You get plugged into a small group, 10 weeks in which you can grow closer to God and each other. Highly recommend that. Also, at the Grow kiosk, you can sign up for a small group. So if you want to be in this for longer than 10 weeks, you want to be a part of a small group that meets weekly, you can sign up for a small group. They would love to have you. You can do that at the Grow kiosk. And then right after second service at 12:15, we are going to have our Mexico mission trip information meeting. That's for high school students that want to take their spring break, go to Mexico, help out Tijuana Christian Mission, who we've been supporting for many, many years, go on a mission trip during spring break, find out all the information you need at 12:15 today. Anyway, this is a program that you probably got when you came in. It has a Connect card attached to it. If you want to find out any information about how to get involved, or if you would like prayer, we would love to do that. Just rip this out, fill this out, then just rip it out and put it in the offering bags as they're passed. All right, now we're going to stand up and greet one another, but do so with this question. Do you remember your very first car? Ask somebody that. Find out what their very first car that they bought with their own money was. Go ahead and stand up and greet those around you.
Hey, good morning, Northwest Christian Church. We're one church, three locations. Again, hope your 2020 is off to a great start. Well, as most of you know, I had some surgery last week. You want to see a scar? Got one. Just kidding. But seriously, I want to thank you for your prayers. I'm recovering nicely. Post-pathology looks great. So it looks like you're still stuck with me for a while. Well, we're on to 2020. Praying to see you in person next week. Excited about our new series, Trip Check 2020. We've set our destination. Now, this week, we're going to look at the dashboard. We're going to look at the gauges to see what we need to do so that we can go all the way on this epic trip with God. Chris is going to look at the check engine light. So make sure that you just don't ignore it. So would you have Chris welcome him up here right now?
I was just up here. You don't need to do that. All right. How many remember their very first car? Let's see it. Let's see it. All right, next question, follow-up question. How many consider their very first car to be your favorite car? Anybody? Less hands. I like it, though. That's great. First car. My very first car that I paid with my own money was a 1997 Ford Escort ZX2. The power of photography makes this look a whole lot better than I remember it. But ZX2, very important distinction. It wasn't just like any other Ford Escort. It was a ZX2, which meant that it was the sportier version of just a regular Ford Escort. Now, I know what you're thinking. How can you get sportier than a Ford Escort? They made a way. They found a way, all right? Basically, it's just smaller. I could reach in any point in that car and get whatever I wanted while driving. It was not safe. Admittedly, I'm not a car guy. If it goes from A to B, then I'm usually generally pretty happy. And once those warning indicator lights show up on the dashboard, I have a tendency to take those as mild suggestions. And there was a time when that same Ford Escort, the check engine light came on, and it came on for about a week. And during that week, I would see it, and I would be like, I wonder what that's about. I wonder what that's about, and I really wouldn't do anything about it. And then suddenly, after about a week, it stopped. It just went away. And I thought, oh, awesome, I have one of those self-healing cars that pinpoint the problem, automatically heal itself. That must be what the ZX2 means. But not too long after that, I went to start it. All the gauges went haywire, and it didn't start, and the alternator went out, and I had to go and get it fixed. And my unofficial philosophy that I realized at that moment was that I'd probably just pretend like everything is okay, and then if it's not okay, I'll deal with it then. It's not a great philosophy for car maintenance, but regarding our life, it's not a great philosophy either. As a matter of fact, it can get us into a lot of trouble. So last week, David started this series called Trip Check 2020, and he pinpointed exactly what we need to know when we start a trip. If you were to go on a road trip, you check everything. You make sure that you can get from point A to point B without any sort of complications. And David talked about the need for us to know where we are going, to know exactly where we are going, to have that intentional direction in our life. And each week in this series, we are going to be able to see some specific aspects in our life, in which case there might be some gauges, there might be some warnings, some indicators in which we need to take note. All right, so from empty to full, where are we in these very specific aspects in life? And I'm going to give you a heads up, and I'm going to give you a little warning. These aspects of life are personal. They are things in which we might actually struggle with, and we have to really take some honest time to have some evaluation and determine where we're at in that. Are we being the healthiest version of ourselves that we can be? Ultimately, this is what we want. We want to be the person that God wants us to be. And in order to do that, we need to actually take note as to where we're at in our life, because I believe that things are connected, just like a car, all right? I want everything to be perfect top to bottom in order to have a smooth ride. And if one thing is off, it affects the performance of the car. And today, we're going to see if that check engine light is on in our life in regards to our physical health, how we treat our bodies. Because I believe that God has a purpose and a plan for how we treat our bodies. Now, I'll admit, in preparation of this sermon, I was a little nervous when preparing this because it's not really something that's talked a lot about in church. Physical health, nutrition, food, all of that stuff. But it's something that's obviously talked a lot about in culture. As a matter of fact, David mentioned this last week. When we start the new year, it happens every single year, we maybe make some goals or some resolutions, and each year, the top three resolutions have to do with exercise and food and nutrition. Eat healthier, I want to exercise more, I want to lose that little bit of weight. And we see that every year, and really this year isn't that different. And we might see it with not only ourselves, but we might see it with the people around us as well. As a matter of fact, this past week we had a student ministry lunch meeting in which we got an email that week saying, what would you like? And we were given two options. We were given the option of pizza, and we were given the option of salad. And all of us separately, individually, chose salad. That's how you know it's January, all right? We need to eat salad now so that we can hang out with students at McDonald's and Taco Bell later. That's how I see it. But talk to us again in March, find out exactly if we're sticking with that. But we see it all around us. It doesn't really take an internet deep dive to understand that we live in a day and age in which we know more about the human body than we've ever known before. We know more about what's good for it and what's bad for it, and we have all the data that tells us what we should or shouldn't be doing. And yet, the trends for physical health continue to head in the opposite direction. Why is that? Why is that? I think one thing, an example of why this might be the case, is because knowledge isn't usually enough to change behavior. Knowledge isn't usually enough sometimes to change our behavior. For instance, I know I need to change my oil more frequently, but if I can get from point A to point B without any major complications, I'll put it off just a little bit longer. Knowledge does not sometimes change behavior. We know that this is a flawed philosophy, though, because sometimes if we push it just far enough, we might find ourselves on the proverbial side of the road asking for help. Now, when you add that to the equation of really having a never-ending list of information regarding all things food and nutrition, it can be overwhelming. Have you ever been overwhelmed when you started something? You're like, I need to make a change in my life, but now I need to do the research part. Admittedly, I love the research part. I'm like, all about the research part. And then I find out there is a ton of stuff out there, and that sometimes can be paralyzing. It can keep us from doing anything. Just in nutrition alone, am I supposed to eat paleo, keto? Am I supposed to eat plants, macro counting, high carb, low carb, no carb at all? All of that's in play if you just do a little research. Just in fitness, am I supposed to do Orange Theory, HIIT training, CrossFit, TRX? Was I supposed to buy my wife a Peloton bike for Christmas? The answer is no. All right? All of that stuff, and then you have 18 different types of yoga. Who knows? They have acro yoga, aerial yoga. My favorite, personally, that I heard of recently, this is an actual thing, goat yoga. Goat yoga is a thing that you can actually sign up for, I know. If you do it, I'm sorry, I don't mean to make fun. It's overwhelming, I know it is, but what I want to do is simply ask a question. I want to ask a question this morning that I believe is very important. Most important question that we can ask in regards to how we treat our bodies is why? Why? Why should we do anything at all? Why should we take good care of our bodies? We have to start with that question, and I believe the Bible has something to say about that. As a matter of fact, we're going to go to the Old Testament, and in this specific time of the Old Testament, there were some people that God was moving. He was moving the Israelites, but suddenly, some of those Israelites were held captive. They were taken from their homes, and they were brought to Babylon. Specifically, there was a handful of men, considered these up-and-comers. They were strong, they had a lot of potential, and the king saw them and said, you're going to be in my inner place. You're going to be in my palace. You're going to eat what I eat. You're going to be living in my quarters. And honestly, these Jewish men that had a lot of potential were living a pretty good life, even though they were in captivity. Even though they were away from their families, it could have been a lot worse. And they looked around and said, you know what? This isn't too bad. But there was one big problem. Their creator God was still the God that they worshiped. But the king and the Babylonians worshiped a whole lot of other gods. And so the problem for these Jewish men was that in the king's palace, there were a lot of religious activity that just didn't really go with what they believed. As a matter of fact, there were ceremonial activities such as sacrifices to false gods, and there was one false god in particular that they would sacrifice both meat and wine to. And this false god went by the name of Marduk. Now, they had a ton of other false gods, but this was like the main primary false god that they worshipped. And they would do this regularly, as a matter of fact, daily. And when the ceremony was over, they would take what was left over, and they would eat that meat and wine at the king's table. And so they went and worshiped God with this meat and wine, and then they would take the leftovers of that, and they would go and face the king and eat the same meat and wine, and the king was supposed to be the embodiment of this false god. And so essentially, what he was asking these Jewish men and women to do were to sit there and eat that meat and drink that wine and worship the king, who is the embodiment of this false god. Now, the problem with that is that if they were to drink the wine, eat the meat, they would in fact be worshiping a false god. So one person stands up and says, I have a problem with this. I have a problem with this. Throughout the Old Testament, we see courage. We see God move in the hearts of men and women in really courageous ways. And sometimes it takes standing up and saying, I don't agree with what's happening right now. And Daniel was that person. Daniel stood up and said, here's the issue. I don't have a problem with the meat. I don't have the problem with the wine, but I have a problem with that meat. I have a problem with that wine, and I'm not gonna defile myself. He says that in chapter 1, verse 8. It says, but Daniel resolved not to defile himself with the royal food and wine, and he asked the chief official for permission not to defile himself this way. See, Daniel gets it. He understands the why. It's not just about health and nutrition. He's saying, I would be dedicating myself to someone that I don't believe in. I would be worshiping a God that I don't believe actually exists. I'm going to continue to worship the one true creator God. That is why I'm not going to partake in this meal. And so it goes on in verse 9, says this, now God had caused the official to show favor and compassion to Daniel. But the official told Daniel, I am afraid of my lord the king who has assigned your food and drink. Why should he see you looking worse than the other men your age? The king would then have my head because of you. There were some drastic consequences for what he was asking. Daniel then said to the guard whom the chief official had appointed over Daniel, his friends Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, please, test your servants for 10 days, just 10 days. Give us nothing but vegetables to eat and water to drink. Then compare our appearance with that of the young men who ate the royal food and treat your servants in accordance with what you see. So he agreed to this and tested them for 10 days. At the end of the 10 days, they looked healthier and better nourished than any of the young men who ate the royal food. So the guard took away their choice food and the wine they were to drink and gave them vegetables instead. Bummer. Bummer. Now I'm going to step aside right now and just have a little conversation with you guys. I can see the panic start to brew. I can see you thinking, Chris, are you asking what I think you're asking? If I need to follow Jesus, do I need to become a vegetarian? Here's the thing. Here's the thing about that. The Bible has both prescriptive texts and descriptive texts. A prescriptive text is a text in which prescribes something of you. God says, this is the best way for you to live your life, similar to a doctor. If he were to give you a prescription, he would say, if you want to get better, I would suggest you follow these orders. An example of a prescriptive text would be when Jesus is asked what the greatest commandment is, and he says, love your neighbor as yourself. He's saying, if you want to know the best possible way to live life, then you should love the people around you. You should love your family. You should love those that are close to you. You should love the people that maybe you don't even know. You should love the people that actually maybe get on your nerves. If you want to live the best possible life, that is how you should live your life. There is no gray area about that. Jesus is saying, do this. It is a command. An example of a descriptive text, which is just something that describes a circumstance. An example of that would be the story we just read. That is a descriptive text. But does that mean it doesn't prescribe anything? Not necessarily. It prescribes something, okay? But it might not be exactly what you read. I believe it prescribes something that you see later on in the New Testament. It prescribes a way of thinking that Paul talks about when he writes a letter to the church in Corinth. He says this. He says this in chapter 6, verse 19. Paul's writing this letter, and he says this. He talks about the bodies that we have. He says, do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit, who is in you, whom you have received from God? Don't you know that? You are not your own, and then it's really important, catch this, you were bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your body. That's what Daniel was doing. That's what Daniel was doing. It wasn't about his health. It wasn't that he wanted to stay away from red meat for a while. It was simply the fact that he wanted to make sure that God was honored through his actions, and that meant he needed to be aware of what he put inside his body. See, that was as countercultural then as it is now. And what Paul was talking about had more to do at that time with how we treat our bodies in a sexual way, but the principle can apply in a broader way. And so the Greek philosophers at that day that Paul was competing with, he was competing with these Greek philosophers in thought, And they believed that at the end of the day, the body was corrupt, that it was broken, that was an evil thing that needed to be suppressed and sometimes even punished, which led to a lot of self-harm in that day. And Paul is saying something that is very counter to that. He's saying that God, our creator, created our body, that it is God's gift, that it is God's design, and it is his creation. I saw something just this morning on social media. Sometimes you can see some really kind of cool things, and it said this, and someone said, sometimes we see a sunset and automatically give credit to God, and then sometimes we look in the mirror in that same breath and immediately put down what we see. God is the creator of both sunsets and our body, and that's what Paul is saying. He deserves to be honored. He deserves to be worshiped for what he has created. And we see the human body is something astounding. Its design is genius. It doesn't take a lot of research to realize that. Look at the human eyeball. Do some research on the intricacies of the human eyeball, and you see that really only a creator could be in charge of that. If you're an engineer, look at the knee or the ankle and find out how that serves our purposes perfectly. Find out about our central nervous system. Look at the details of that. Our bodies can do some incredible things, and they are built to do incredible things, and they are built to be able to worship God through our activities. For instance, this is Pam Reed. Pam Reed is one of the most amazing ultra marathon runners that we've ever known. She was the first woman to run and win the Badwater Ultra Marathon. And there's a reason why the word ultra is in front of the word marathon, because what was required of them was crazy. They had to run 135 miles through Death Valley in July with temperatures hitting 100 degrees. And it's been documented that she once ran 300 miles without stopping. Without stopping. That fact is gonna haunt me when I get winded checking my mail, all right? 300 miles. As a matter of fact, when she finished that, she said it was one of the most cool experiences that she's ever had while running. It took her about 4 days. Cool. That's exactly how I would describe it too. But incredible, right? Absolutely incredible what it means when we push what God has given us to something beyond what we think it can go. This next person is named Eddie Hall. When it comes to strength, there's not much that are stronger than him. He set the deadlift world record by lifting 1,102 pounds. Guys, that's the equivalent of a buffalo, all right? He basically lifted a buffalo. Next time you're standing next to a buffalo, try to lift it. Just see what Eddie, happens a lot, I'm sure. See what Eddie went through. You guys might know the name Usain Bolt. Usain Bolt has a lot of gold medals. He also has the world record in the 100 and the 200. And then he casually went to the NFL Combine last year and decided, you know what, I'm just going to run the 40. All right, so he stretched a little bit and he ran the 40. Each NFL player was running the 40-yard dash and being timed and tested for NFL teams. And then he ran it and set an NFL record with 4.22 seconds. Casually. I'm sure all the running backs in the NFL were super happy he came out. It's unbelievable what humans are capable of and what we can do with our bodies. And you see, God designed our bodies like he did everything else. He designed it with purpose. He designed it with purpose in mind. Our purpose might not be the same purposes in which we just saw. But I think all of us have the same purpose. All of us have a general purpose, and that is to worship him with our bodies. So, if we go back to Old Testament times, we see that God's presence, where people went to be in the place of God, to be in God's presence, was a temple. That's what God wanted. He said, go to the temple. That's where you will see me. And so God's presence was inhabited in a temple. And then somewhere along the way, after Jesus, after his death, after his burial, after his resurrection, made it really clear that there doesn't have to be just a temple anymore. As a matter of fact, God's presence can exist anywhere. God's presence can exist in our bodies. Our bodies became the place where the Holy Spirit took up residence. Jesus talked about before leaving, he said, each of you will have the Holy Spirit. I will be with you. That's what Jesus said to his disciples before he left. That's what gave them reassurance. That's what gave them hope. And it should give us hope too, that Jesus is saying, I am within you. My Holy Spirit is in you. Therefore, what does that mean for us? Whatever we do with our bodies is an act of worship to someone or something. Have you thought about it in that way? Whatever we do with our bodies, it's an act of worship, whether it's good or bad, whether it's to our God, the Creator, or not, it is an act of worship. Paul pushes a little bit further, and we read it. He says, you are not your own. You're not your own. Now, that's not a popular message today. In the culture that we live in, it's very easy to say, what I do with my body is my business. And yet Paul would push back on that, and he would say, no, I don't think that's true. I don't think that's true. Why? Because you were bought at a price. What was that price? What was that price? I think sometimes these words become familiar to us, but don't let the familiarity desensitize us to the power of John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that he gave his one and only son. That's the price that was paid for me and you. So we don't have the option of telling God, God, you just worry about the spiritualness of myself and don't worry about the physical aspect of my life. We don't have the option of doing that because our body is not our own. That's not the way it works. And Paul goes on to say, honor God with your body. What does honor mean? It means to lift up, to glorify, to demonstrate what you believe to be true about God in everything that you do. Have you thought about it? The actions that I take, how I treat my body, how I perceive my body, what I compare my body to, demonstrates what I believe to be true about God. It's a harsh reality. And that's why this series, each sermon, we are going to be faced with the opportunity to evaluate our thoughts on very personal things in our life. And so the thing is, if you really want to demonstrate your faithfulness to God by how you treat your body, there might need to be some practical changes in our life in order to do that better. And health and fitness are talked about a lot, but when it comes down to it, the stats tell a little bit of a different story. Last year, there was a Time magazine study in which they kind of ranked each state and the country according to our health and fitness. Oregon was pretty good. Oregon is a pretty healthy place, but the country as a whole suffered a little bit. As a matter of fact, they said only 23% of Americans get the recommended 150 minutes of moderate physical activity in a week, which comes to about 20 minutes a day. So 20 minutes a day doing some moderate physical activity, about 23% of Americans. And I get it. The go-to excuse for me for many years has been, there's just not enough time in the day. I lead a busy life, and I don't know if I can always fit that in. And this happens, and life changes. As a matter of fact, a few months before our baby came, I had torn my ACL. I tore my ACL playing basketball, and in effect, it kind of took away an important piece of my life, which was just physical exercise and activity. And after I tore my ACL, after I had surgery, I was doing rehab pretty consistently. And then we got word that not only would we be adopting a baby girl, but she came 5 weeks early. And so we went to Florida, we adopted the baby, came back, McKenna was with us, and then guess what took a little bit of a sidetrack? Guess what I didn't really get back to? Rehab. And I had a good excuse. I thought, there are more important things going on in my life right now. The thing is, my wife, who is a physical therapist by trade, says you can fit it in because it's important. And she reminded me that if I want to play sports, if I want to go on hikes with my daughter 8, 10, 15 years from now, I need to put in the work now. And that matters to me. And I believe it matters to God too. When he looks at our longevity, when he looks at our life, he wants to see us create disciplines in which we put in the work now. And I think sometimes we can evaluate our relationship with God and say, God, as long as I'm spiritually healthy, which means this, as long as I have some spiritual disciplines in my life, for instance, going to church, maybe reading the Bible, maybe praying, as long as I have those disciplines in my life, God, you shouldn't care that I don't pursue physical health consistently. And I don't think Jesus thought of it like that when he was asked what the greatest commandment is. He said this. He simply said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. God could have answered that in a different way. Jesus could have answered that in a different way. He could have said, just love God and love your neighbor. But instead, he created a list that contains different aspects of who he created us to be. And he said, love the Lord your God with these things. And I think it creates a larger point. I think he's saying, love God with everything you have inside of you, with everything that I've created you be. Don't leave an aspect of your life out in which you have the opportunity to worship God. See, our bodies are a good thing that is meant to demonstrate that God is the ultimate thing. That phrase can be flipped on its head a little bit, and you can say that when a good thing becomes an ultimate thing, it actually becomes a destructive thing. There are a lot of good things in this life, but aside from Jesus, they should never be the main thing. They should always remain just a good thing. No matter what end of the spectrum you want to look at, whether it's food or fitness, it's possible to let either one of those things become the ultimate thing in our life. I had a professor in college say this many times in reference to a lot of things, but also in reference to our view of fitness. And he said, wherever you run to first to find comfort reveals what you believe to be God. Wherever you run to for your main source of comfort reveals to be what you believe to be God. And so if I run to food for comfort, which I have in the past, I have done that, to be my main source of comfort, that's what I believe to be for God. If I run to the gym for my main source of comfort in my distress, when life gets tough and I like need peace and I need comfort, and I immediately run to someplace else other than to Jesus, and that is my God. See, culture points us to body worship, but the Bible points us to worship God with our bodies. There's a huge distinction between those two things. There are two different ways this can play out in our life in the way that we worship. And the first one I'll just call passive body worship, and the other one I'll call active body worship. Both don't worship God, but rather worship our bodies. Passive body worship is when you simply passively give in to whatever the body wants. You just give in to the cravings of the body. You do whatever your body is asking you to do, and you don't think twice about it. You just continue to give in and continue to give in. This happens, I'm going to be really honest, guys, this happens every single time my wife makes chocolate chip cookies. They are the best. And I can tell you exactly how this plays out in my life. She makes chocolate chip cookies, she puts them in a jar, and I think, perfect, I'm going to have two. Totally good. I go and have two. 5 minutes later, my body starts speaking to me, and it says, I bet if you have one more, that's fine. And I continue to go back, and I get one more. And it says, you should have another one. And before I know it, there's 10 missing out of that jar. In that way, I am passively just listening and following orders. Am I following God's orders in that situation? I don't think so. I'm just following the orders that my body gives me. Active body worship is when we obsess over our bodies. We stare in the mirror. We stress out when standing on the scale, and everything begins to revolve around our fitness and nutrition, but not for the reasons that we should have them. Rather, we are so concerned about how we are perceived by others that we will do anything to look a certain way. It's idolatry when we worship at the altar of our own reflection. Whether it's passive or active, body worship takes on many different forms, but you can always identify it when it starts to cost you very important things in your life. There is a cost to worshiping our bodies, whether it's passively or actively. And we can see those costs. Like a car dashboard has gauges, we can see the needle move a little bit if we pay attention. And so if there is a cost, what are those costs? I think the first one is just important relationships. When we worship anything but God, our relationships start to suffer. When your family is the victim of your fitness obsession and they're not getting the attention that they need, you have discovered your God in that situation. Now, if you were to allow your health to deteriorate because of sheer neglect, and it hampers your ability to connect with and enjoy life with the people that matter, that is your God. If we're missing out on opportunities that God has for us because we're so obsessed with this other thing that God still calls good, that has somehow become the ultimate thing, our relationships will suffer for that. Next thing is time. Time. If your time is wasted passively consuming unhealthy food with no physical output, you met your God. But if you spend all your time at the gym at the expense of investing in and serving others, you've met your God. There are so many opportunities that God has given us to be a part of something bigger than ourselves. And we have to be able to take advantage of those opportunities while still taking care of our body. And that's a really tough thing to do. That's a tough thing to manage. The last thing that suddenly we start to see a gauge move and we start to see the cost in our life is money. And the thing is, in order to put any sort of prioritization on something like food and nutrition in our life, it's going to require some money. But if you spend all of your money on unnecessary, and that's the key, just unnecessary workout equipment, the latest workout trends, fitness clothing, juice that costs $15 a bottle, you've met your God. On the flip side, if all your money is spent in the drive-thru, rather than making and preparing real food, then you've met your God. And false gods, here's the thing about false gods, they always require more of what is important in your life. They always require more of your relationships and your time and your money until there's nothing left. You see, when a good thing becomes an ultimate thing, it actually becomes a destructive thing. Because we are human, we have most likely given into these at various times in our life. And when we worship the one true God, when we're doing all of this through the lens that we are worshiping God with our body, when we get this right, we can look at those same gauges with very different results. Suddenly our relationships start to get better. Suddenly there's time in the day in which we're managing it in an efficient way, in which God is leading us so that we can actually take advantage of the opportunities that he puts in front of us. Our money starts to serve us rather than us serving our money. So how do we evaluate this? How do we look at this? How do we evaluate this in our own life? This is a question that I came across in my preparation that kind of just helped frame this for me. It says this: if someone were to watch what we put in our bodies and what we do with our bodies for 1 week, what would they conclude that we believe to be true about the God who made our bodies? What would that person conclude about who we think God is? About who created our bodies? That's a tough question. And so I've been on both sides of this issue for years, whether it's passive body worship or active body worship. And when the opportunity for it to be destructive in my life creeps up, it's something that I need to notice. And there are times in which I let it become an ultimate thing. And there are times in which I've had it right where it should be. And the differences are amazing in our life. And it's going to be tough. It's a tough thing to manage for all of us. And the thing is, it's going to be something we struggle to manage for the rest of our life. That's just the way it is. That's just the case. Some people might struggle with it more than others, but it is a tough thing that will really affect us for the rest of our days until God gives us new bodies. Until God gives us new bodies. Paul talks about this in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 1. He says, "For we know that when this earthly tent we live in is taken down, that is, when we die and leave this earthly body, we will have a house in heaven, an eternal body made for us by God himself and not by human hands. We grow weary in our present bodies, and we long to put on our heavenly bodies like new clothing." Guys, it's stressful to think about how to manage all of this, but we have a hope in our Creator that one day we will get to spend eternity with him in these new bodies that he has given us. So that's the why. While we're here on earth in our temporary bodies, we should be worshiping him with every aspect of who we are. That's the why. What moves us to act? What moves us to do specific things? I'm going to worship God with my body. But what about the how? What about the how, according to all of this? How do we go about worshiping and honoring God with our bodies? And this is the mess that we can get in sometimes with the abundance of information that's out there. But we're going to simplify things. We're going to simplify things, and we're going to let this quote kind of lead the way right now. It's ex-Navy SEAL and author, a guy by the name of Jocko Willink, just says this. It's simply, discipline equals freedom. Discipline equals freedom. And that's true for a lot of things in life, but it's certainly true of fitness and nutrition. So if we wanted to live in such a way today that will help us thrive for tomorrow, what changes do we need to start making? And the first change that we need to start making, or maybe this first thing that we need to start thinking about, is not revolutionary. It's not something that you don't already know. As a matter of fact, I'm going to give you two things, two ways in which we can worship God with our bodies. And the first one is simply this. Movement, moving your body, is better than not moving your body. Simple. You guys probably know that already. I get that. But then when we start to look at the ins and outs of our day, it can get difficult. It can get difficult. I remember looking at my dad and seeing the schedule that he had. He had 12-hour shifts when he worked. There was no time. There was very little time. And any other available time was due basically for connecting with kids and family and just being a good husband and a good dad. And so I get how difficult that is. But we all have that kind of that same amount of time, and sometimes there's a way in which we can create that in our day. What time do you get up in the morning? Can you get up a half an hour earlier? What time do you go to bed at night? Can you go to bed a half an hour later and just use that time for movement? Go for a walk, stretch, jump rope, push-ups, burpees, deadlift 1,000 pounds. Actually, don't do that. That's unhealthy. These are things that we can do, though, just to be able to say, God, thank you for the opportunity just so I can move my body, because not all of us have that. I love that this church, that we offer Fit for Life, in which seniors can come together and exercise as a group, but also get accountability and get community from that. And that's really what we want. We want us to be able to connect with other people in this very practical aspects of our life. Can you imagine having to do all of this alone? And this is why we do Rooted. This is why we put people in groups that have 10-week experiences so that we can say, guys, this is what I'm struggling with. I'm struggling to worship God with my body. Help me do this. As a matter of fact, can we meet up? Can we go for a walk together? Can we talk about life? That's why we have small groups in which we can sign up for, so we don't have to do all of this alone. The second thing, once again, this is all stuff you already know, but it's a good reminder, and it's stuff that I've been convicted of. Eating real food is better than fake food. Better than fake food. Guys, I can tell you what fake food is because I have it consistently. I can go into my pantry, I can look, and when I start to get those, like, that sweet tooth that I call it, I can go to the Oreo packages. That's exactly where I go. And I can take an Oreo, two cookies. What is between those two cookies? White cream. I have no clue what that is. I have no clue. Does that stop me? Absolutely not. Continue to put it in my mouth multiple times. Real food is better than fake food, though. We can see an apple grow from a tree. We can see that God provides that. That is something that I probably dedicate more time and energy into rather than these Oreos. My wife is going to really hate me for this one, but even things that say diet, Diet Coke. Diet Coke people are crazy, and so I'm going to tread carefully here, all right? It might say no sugar, no calories, all of that stuff, but I think it's still kind of bad for you. All of us know that, and all of us know this too. There's no magic formula. There's no easy way out of this, which is why we started this conversation with that quote, discipline equals freedom, because everything in life that God gives us that is good requires some amount of discipline. If we want our spiritual life to be as good as it can possibly be, we have to dedicate and discipline ourselves to read the Bible a little bit, to pray a little bit. And when God says, worship me with your bodies, he's not saying, this is just an easy way, this isn't just a mindset. Rather, there's going to be some things that you need to discipline yourself to do, and that's what I've been convicted of. Remember Daniel, the very beginning of the story, we talked about Daniel. Later on in his story, there was a decree that had been handed down to him, basically saying, Daniel, you cannot worship your God, your one true creator God anymore. You cannot pray to that God. And Daniel responded by saying this, or rather by doing this. In chapter 6, the book of Daniel, verse 10, he says, but when Daniel learned that the law had been signed, he went home, and there's a few key phrases that I want you to see. He went home and knelt down as usual, in his upstairs room with its windows open towards Jerusalem. He prayed three times a day, just as he always had, just as he had always done, giving thanks to his God. There were disciplines in Daniel's life that helped him when life got tough. When that king said, I am going to clamp down on you and I'm going to make this life very, very difficult, he did what he always did. He prayed just like he always prayed. He gave thanks to God just as he always had done. Discipline equals freedom. And so we need to discipline ourselves to think in such a way. Is God the ultimate thing? Is God the ultimate thing? At first, discipline yourself to think about the why before we think about the how. Is God the ultimate thing, or is food the ultimate thing, or is fitness the ultimate thing in my life? Is God the ultimate thing? And so when you consider the gauge on the dashboard representing the health of your body, you first have to answer that question and know that we are created and our body is not our own. How can I continue to worship God with my body? Eugene Peterson paraphrases 1 Corinthians 6:19 through 20, which we had already read in this way, and it kind of just gives a little bit of a different take on it, and we're going to end with this. He says, or didn't you realize that your body is a sacred place, the place of the Holy Spirit? Don't you see that you can't live however you please, squandering what God has paid such a high price for? The physical part of you is not some piece of property belonging to the spiritual part of you. God owns the whole works. So, let people see God in and through your body. Let people see God in and through your body. What we believe about this demonstrates to the people that are looking at us what we believe to be true about our Creator, God. Right now, we're going to go into this time of communion. The band's going to come up, the servers are going to go back, and there's going to be some plates that are passed through the aisle. And in this time, we can remember and reflect that God has paid a high price for us. Exactly how high price that was, he went to the cross so that we can have freedom. He went to the cross so that we can experience grace. He went to the cross so that we can live this life and worship God with everything that we have, including our bodies. And so right now, I'm gonna pray for this time of communion. I'm gonna pray that when we take the piece of bread and when we take that little bit of juice, we can remember that Jesus sacrificed all of that, but he didn't stop there. He showed us that life always wins and that he is the life giver. And he raised up and he resurrected from the dead to show us that he is the one true creator. Let's pray. God, we thank you so much for who you are. We thank you for giving us grace. We thank you for giving us and showing us love in ways that we can't imagine in such an extreme way. God, you have created us, and I pray that we may worship you with our physical body, Lord. I pray that everything that we do may demonstrate something about you, how you are the ultimate thing. Thank you. Thank you for giving us the freedom to live this life. Thank you for the blessings you have given us, and I just pray that no matter where we are at in the journey, no matter what our current situation is, we may worship you. We love you and we thank you. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Time of generosity, I'd like to have the ushers come forward. And please join us as we sing this last song of praise to him.
Great to worship with all of you. If you heard something today and you just would like some prayer, we would love to pray with you. We have Mark right over here, Jan right over here. They would love to pray with you. And then once again, we have small group signups at the Grow kiosk in the back, so make sure you do that. Anyway, have a great rest of your Sunday. See you later.